Well, if you were in Auckland CBD on Tuesday, you'll know how chaotic it was to get around in a state of emergency due to heavy rain and flooding. Roads were gridlocked and public transport was at a standstill.
It was a bit confusing because they told us to leave early and then now they're saying delay travel, so we kind of just want to get home.
We were down here at 12 and then we had stood in the line for about 45 minutes and it had moved about 5 metres.
I left work at 1 and it's now 3:10 and I've still got to get to Torbay.
I made my way from Newmarket, so it's probably been 2 hours now just trying to get home, basically.
It's clear our cities are woefully underprepared for dealing with disasters, but there are solutions that can make a difference. For more, we're joined by Tim Welch, a senior lecturer in urban planning at the University of Auckland. Morena, Tim.
Morena.
You're obviously the smart guy. You walked home, did you, on the other day?
Well, I wasn't that smart. I walked and I got soaked, but I definitely wasn't waiting for a bus or trying to drive out of the city.
What were you thinking as you walked past all of those people waiting at the bus stop, all of those people in cars stuck there?
Mostly what I was thinking is, how do we reduce the number of cars in the city? The city doesn't need to have this many single occupancy vehicles jamming the roads, especially at a time of emergency. So we need to make more space for public transportation so our system can kind of flow and we don't have people stranded in the city when they need to get out.
So there's been a lot of call for renewed infrastructure, the railway lines aren't good enough, et cetera, et cetera. What's the cheapest, quickest way to get better solutions fast in Auckland?
The thing we can do starting immediately and have an immediate effect is remove that on-street car parking on our major roads and paint those lines for dedicated busways, and that would keep the buses going. We could have a congestion charge, so charge people a fee to get into the city, especially at the peak hours, and that would reduce the number of people coming into the city also. So it's reducing that demand for cars and the places that we store them that occupy all those city streets that could be used for other things.
So with things like bus lanes, buses obviously were part of the traffic that were gridlocked in Auckland. Would it be better just to have a full bus lane going down to the motorway and through the city as well?
Sure, yeah. If we look at like the North Shore, where we have a dedicated busway, it's probably one of the most successful transportation projects in New Zealand. It carries tons of people very fast. So if we could carry that across the bridge and into the city, we wouldn't see the problems to the level we are now. We need to eventually add things like light rail and a second crossing from the harbor. But if we want to do things starting now, these are the easy steps we can take.
Okay, so get rid of parks, get bus lanes in. That should be fairly easy to do, I'd imagine.
Right.
Longer term, a bit more expensive. What else can we do potentially in big strips like Queen Street, for instance?
Yeah, Queen Street, Dominion Street, all of these big wide streets can accommodate things like light rail, which could go above ground. People could easily get on and get off. It would support businesses locally. It would, again, move people a lot faster than any single car could.
Light rail might be pushing it with all of the parties at the moment, but are there things that we can do within those streets, within the infrastructure, to help things like having green spaces or that kind of thing to absorb some of that water, for instance?
Certainly, yeah. A term I've been throwing around lately is bioswales, and it's kind of a wonky term for essentially plants and trees that are located kind of where cars are parked right now. But that would allow the water rushing down the street, instead of seeing that river we see flooding Queen Street or whatever major road, it would catch a lot of that and let it slowly drain into the ground. And the important thing there is it filters the water before it gets out to the sea. So we would see less of beaches being closed all across the city every time we have a heavy rain.
So it's taking our concrete jungle and just greenifying it a bit more, is it?
It is, and it's making us more resilient, because what it'll do also is help cool our cities and reduce what we call that the heat island effect, which is the sun beating down on all that pavement, making it really hot for people to walk around.
How much of a concern is it if we were to have a situation like an earthquake or a tsunami in Auckland and people were in the situation they were in the other day trying to drive out and everyone was stuck?
Yeah, clearly sitting in a car in traffic is kind of like the sci-fi movies we see where something terrible is happening and everybody's in their car. That's not the situation we want to see. So we'd want to see staggered releases of people, but we would want to prioritize getting people onto those public transportation modes very quickly. They're the highest capacity, the most efficient, they take up the least amount of space in the city. So getting them to public transportation and getting them to where they need to be is kind of the number one priority.
So we know the problems. You've got a couple of easy solutions. What's the next step? How do we get our leaders on board with these?
Well, that's the hard part, is because even simple things like removing car parks has been controversial. But I think most of us can get behind the idea that we need to get our public transportation system moving. We can't keep seeing canceled bus routes and other things like that. So if we can free up space for public transportation, we'll see less of that.
I will say, come with solutions, not problems. Tim Welch, you've done that from the Auckland University, senior lecturer in urban planning. Thanks for joining us.
My pleasure. Thank you.